A very good evening to one and all out here. We, on behalf of Calcutta Business School, which is a unit of Shikshayatan Foundation, welcome the speakers and all the participants, and other than the school's college students who are hearing us out live through Facebook, a very warm welcome to all. Today we have our two esteemed speakers who would be talking on a very contemporary and relevant topic on the digital transformation. We have Ms. Neha Khanna, who is the AVP Talent Acquisition from Lido Learning. And we have Mr. Priyank Agarwal, who is the National Head Key Accounts PhonePe. So education sector, EdTech sector and the FinTech sector are the two most emerging sectors. Courtesy this COVID-19 case, which has led these two sectors to emerge and the transformation that has happened through this digitization. So we would be hearing these two speakers out, and the moderator of today's session is Professor Sanjeev Biswas. Professor Biswas presently serves as an assistant professor in the area of decision sciences, operation management, and information systems at Calcutta Business School. He has around 17 years of experience in academics and industry. His research interests include supply chain management, multi-criteria decision-making techniques and their applications in management, fuzzy logic, total quantity management, technology management, and social implications of operations management. So without much talking from my end, I would hand over the session to our honorable speaker to take it forward, and would eagerly wait from the speakers to hear out how they enlighten us on the very relevant and contemporary topic on digital transformation. Over to you, Professor Biswas.
Thank you. Thank you, Pragya, for keeping it short. And Mr. Agarwal and Mr. Khanna, Ms. Khanna, good afternoon.
Hello, good afternoon.
Good afternoon to Professor Don, our principal in charge, Calcutta Business School, and our faculty colleagues, and all the students, Pragya, and our other colleagues present here. So it's an honor for us to have you, sir and ma'am, on this occasion of this webinar. And Calcutta Business School is a part of 100 years old Shikshayatan Foundation, and CBS is always very keen to impart education on the frontiers of concepts and practices in management science. And as we all aware that EdTech and FinTech, these two are the sectors which are experiencing a huge transformational growth. And it is said that it is a kind of hockey stick kind of growth. And experts believe that more than 100% growth opportunity is there in coming years in these two sectors. And particularly in the context of COVID-19, which has taught us how to learn without going into classroom physically, how to transact without going into bank physically. So we are fortunate to have two experts among us. And I am very much delighted also for another reason, is that this webinar would be like a conversation mode kind of discussion thing. And I am very much happy that our students will be interacting with these honorable speakers who are present here. And we always encourage our students to regularly interact with the industry leaders. We have different center of excellences. One of the center of excellence is data analytics, and one of the center of excellence is cryptocurrency and financial market. All these center of excellence are there. And we always encourage the students to participate actively in these activities along with the faculty members to get to know what are the concepts and practices that are being followed in the marketplace right now. So as a part of that initiative, we organize several webinars on regular basis. Today we are fortunate to have you, Mr. Agarwal and Ms. Khanna. So without any delay, let me introduce Mr. Anamitra Mukherjee, who will be one of the our student who will ask questions, and Ms. Riya Vishwas. Riya, can you? Yes, Riya Vishwas. They will be asking you questions. I am the moderator, but virtually they will take the session forward. So without any delay, may I request Riya to start the proceedings?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for giving us such an excellent opportunity to have an interaction with such dignitaries, and a very good evening to one and all present here. I, Riya Vishwas, a student of Calcutta Business School, PGDM batch 2020-22, would like to extend a warm welcome from me and my co-host, Anamitra Mukherjee. So how many of us are active in technology? Obviously all. Lockdown has impacted a lot in everyone's life. Even our uncle, who used to know only keypad mobile phones, are scrolling Facebooks now. Starting with this very concept, I want to ask from our honorable speakers that technology had brought a drastic change in our conventional methodology, as our session is also online. So do you see its cons or any disruptions in the coming years, if we talk of India in particular?
So you're talking about disruptions that will be brought about by technology.
Yes, sir.
I think we are already seeing a huge disruption, as you spoke about things. And if I were to take it to my sector, fintech, you know, when I started my journey with PhonePe now almost 3 years back, we were talking about cashless payments, right? That let's go cashless, make India cash free, the reduction in cash. If that happens, the black money will reduce, tax flow to government will increase. And as a result of tax flow increase, we will have better amenities for the people of the country. During the time of pandemic, this cashless moved to contactless payment, right? And there was a huge increase in adoption in not only the metro towns and tier ones, but tier two, tier three, and rural villages also, because nobody wanted to touch those currency notes, even how so dear they might be to you. Nobody wanted to touch those plastic cards, you know, however enticing they may look, and nobody wanted to press those four buttons on the keypad of your swiping machine. Everybody wanted to stand at a distance and pay via scanning application, right? So I think there's a huge change, disruption. Earlier, when we talked about digital payments 3 years before from now, it was mainly restricted to just person-to-person money transfer, right? We were talking about, you know, me sending money to you, you sending money to me. Then eventually, as our life is full of bills, right? Nobody's life is without bills. You have gas bill, electricity bill, school fees to pay, mobile, broadband, DTH recharges to make. People started moving towards all the bill payment and recharge use cases. Then came your online website payment, you know, shopping on Flipkart, shopping on Zomato, booking a Ola cab, etc. Now the journey has moved next step to offline store payment, that, you know, paying for your grocery, paying for your haircut, paying for your dry cleaning bill, paying for, you know, any kind of shopping that you are doing, or at a cinema hall. The next journey from here, I think if we talk about disruption, then there's a money journey, right? As you accumulate wealth, there's a money journey which starts from first step is you send money, right? When you earn your first salary, what do? You send money to your parents. You send money to your family. That's the first step. The second step of your journey is to spend money. After sending money, you start spending money. So you spend money on shopping, you spend money on buying food, you spend money on your rents, paying bills, etc. The third and the fourth steps of your money journey is, and with blessings, everybody should reach that journey where you have enough money, where you have to manage your money, and when you want to grow your money. So after sending money, spending money, then you want to manage money. And when you have so much money that your money makes money for you, right? That's when the journey of grow money happens. So we all want to reach that stage where we have so much money in mutual funds, banks and accounts, and we have so many properties that we don't have to earn our wages anymore. That money can earn money for you. So I think the next journey of fintech and the next disruption will come when people start managing money and growing money digitally. Right now, this manage money and grow money for a lot of people in the country is happening via traditional channels, where you are buying property and houses and you are buying land, you are buying gold. Tomorrow, all this will become digital. You will start investing in mutual fund, policies, deposits, etc. And there, that's how you'll manage your money, and that money will then work for you and grow you. So I think, yes, disruption in two ways. One, in immediate disruption that we are seeing is increase in the offline world, increase in brick and mortar stores. And the next stage of disruption is when we'll talk about people managing money and growing money.
Miss Ghosh, can you please mute yourself? Sudeshna, madam, can you please mute yourself?
Yeah. I hope, Riya, that answers your question.
Yes, sir. Totally agree with you on this. Thank you so much for answering this question.
We would also like to take the views of Ms. Khanna also.
Yes, sure, sir. So, I like to believe that we are already in that overpowers. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Yeah, okay, great. So the thing is, we already got acquainted with various tools, technologies, thanks to COVID. It has entirely changed the landscape, right? Until last year, no one could wonder, specifically in a country like India, where we are so heavily dependent on people. It was a game-changing horizon where pretty much all the organizations, they shifted immediately to work from home, and organizations like Microsoft, Google, Siemens, all these big giants, right? They kind of gave their employees indefinite leave. So with this whole shift, I believe that a lot of technology or platforms enabled by technology, they came into picture. I mean, there are a lot of advancements which happen, like Zoom. This kind of a session was not feasible if we were in 2019. Nobody thought of it. The overall engagement rate was not really high, and nobody really thought of investing in platforms like Zoom, right? But there was this spike owing to COVID. And similarly, EdTech is another sector which got blessing in disguise, because schools were shut and nobody else has another avenue. So all education institutes, they shifted to online. All students, they had to like quickly adapt to technology and shift to online. People who were not really acquainted with technology, they also shifted online. And I guess it's working seamlessly fine for a lot of people, and knock on the wood, working really, really fine for EdTech space in general. That said, a lot of other technologies, they kind of got a boost or got an avenue because people started thinking beyond the obvious. So like artificial intelligence and machine learning driven platforms with a lot of predictive analysis, they have started to cater to a lot of products in this newer ecosystem where we are thinking about solving things or online consultancies or online appointments with doctors on platforms like Practo, then virtual reality-led trainings, or maybe immersive learning and gamification. So there are a lot of things which have happened. And I feel they have kind of already disrupted the market, and there's more in the store. So yeah, hopeful that there are more disruptions which India will witness in coming years.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for answering this one. That's a wonderful insight indeed. So my next question is again from here will be answered. So many of us are still unaware of our operations and revenue model of edtech companies. Could you kindly shed light on that?
Sure. So I won't be able to give you the exact details of it. However, I can give you a gist of it. So there are two types of edtechs. Okay. One is product-based edtechs, and second is service-based models, right? Now, product-based edtechs, they primarily are content heavy. They are driving revenue by selling that content. Like there can be a gadget on which the content is preloaded. You sell that gadget for a certain price, and that's basically fetching you revenue and driving revenue for the organization. However, there are service-based organizations which are catering a service, and this customer is only paying for that certain service. However, there were like plethora of services available on that platform. So to give you an example, let's say it's an edtech platform like Lido. So the service could be a tuition class for fifth grade, right? Now, for per class, you need to pay some money so that the teacher is making certain money, because teacher is teaching live. And there's obviously some portion of that revenue that goes to the company, and that's where, you know, you make money. But if the audience is large and in one class there are multiple people, then obviously your revenue multiplies. So that's one side of it. Then second is doubt solving classes, or maybe competitive exam preparation classes. All these are models which are largely under this edtech umbrella. But these are the major sources from where edtechs are driving their revenue. I mean, these are the only sources from where all edtechs are driving their revenue.
Okay, so ma'am, what are the benefits of using technology in education for both sides, institution and students as well?
So you see, technology can increase the reach, right? I'll explain this with an example. If a student was able to access to a certain pool of books or a certain library, or was able to reach to a certain set of subject matters or certain teachers, right, can now reach to better experts via online classroom, and can connect with like-minded students, teachers who he or she would not have got access to if it was just, you know, in-person kind of an interaction. So this is a larger problem statement, which internet has definitely solved for it. And internet is what else? I mean, it's technology. So students can, learn better. They don't have to like really leave the comforts of their household and move somewhere. Like if you know the trend, like, at least in my days when I was opting for engineering, a lot of students used to go to Kota to study for IIT JEE, right? But now all these classes are right there, and you can like pretty much do this. It's just that maybe students, they miss out on the environment, because when you study with like a certain type of students or kids, then obviously the rigor is very different. But that said, the reach is wider. And similarly, when it comes to schools, institutions, they can reach out to a larger audience without investing too much in infrastructure. I mean, if you are building schools or leasing out spaces, then you need to take care of a variety of things, like from basics like a space, chairs, tables, managing the overall logistics of the space. That's too much of a hassle and can be cumbersome for schools. But when you're just doing this online right now, you guys are doing this session in this Zoom call, there are 54 people available, right? But this is streaming live on Facebook. Anyone who wishes to join can join, right? But the reach is obviously larger if a lot of people outside the campus, they join this. That's whosoever has the access to.
Yeah.
So I mean, yeah, that's the benefit of technology in education.
Very well said, ma'am. So how would you find edtech sectors to facilitate upgradation of Indian educator and foster more foreign collaborations?
So edtech is already doing that. I mean, all the education tech companies who are operating in this small ecosystem, they are already doing it in one way or the other. Now, it could be as simple as, you know, grouping kids as per their aptitude instead of a conventional classroom where 25, 30 kids were in one class. I mean, we all have studied in similar classrooms. In schools, we have like 25, 30 kids in one classroom. And nobody is really grouped according to their aptitude. And when I say this, the irony is we are giving the same question paper to people with different mindsets, different aptitude levels, and asking them to perform at same levels, which is unfair. So a lot of edtechs, they are trying to solve for this problem by grouping them as per their aptitude, which is a very foreign approach. Then scaffolding approach in lessons where your lesson unfolds as per your rigor levels, what you have understood in the previous one, and it's largely driven by artificial intelligence or some machine learning algorithm. Then there could be experiential learning, because we can't create a classroom kind of an environment virtually, and you can't like really sit next to each other and talk, but still there has to be some level of experiential learning which needs to happen. So in those areas, excuse me, so a lot of startups, they have embedded technology, and it's not just the rote learning, it's essentially driven by a lot of games, a lot of practical problem solving, which Indian curriculum lacks. We focus a lot, a lot of our teachers, they actually focus on just covering the syllabus and not actually getting the depth of what we are teaching to our kids. So that's there. Then pedagogy, which is embedded with immersive learning techniques like gamification or the cue-based answer solving, where it's a very foreign way of doing it. And I guess a lot of organizations abroad, they were actually doing this. And now it's pretty much available in all Indian edtech products. I mean, most of them, they have these collaborations. And when it comes to senior or secondary education or post-college education, then also I guess a lot of tier one colleges or Ivy League colleges, they have already started these online chapters where no matter where you are living, but you can still do a certain course, maybe upgrade yourself, add some muscle to your CV. All of those collaborations are actually helpful.
So this will be very helpful for students with different kind of aptitudes. Ma'am, I said this will be helpful for different kind of students with different kind of aptitude levels.
Yeah, right? Yeah. I mean, see, India as a country, I mean, largely what we focus on is marks of students, like what they write in their exam sheets, what is their rank. As a country, we normally focus on that. However, if you are picking things from the Western board, they normally focus on what you're bringing to the table, what are your learning levels, how have you learned, what is your practical understanding about certain concepts, right? So that's like really crucial. And with EdTech coming in picture, I guess that shift will happen eventually. We are not there yet, but it will happen. Yeah.
Okay. So as on date, technology in education is mostly adopted by leading higher educational colleges and few schools in India as well. What do you think about the prospect of EdTech in near future?
It's a ever-growing sector. Given the world we are living in, I see a heavy dependency on technology, be it colleges, be it schools. And honestly, I mean, this area is untapped right now. It's the very raw market. And there's definitely growth, which is linked with this another wave of COVID coming in. I don't see schools opening anytime soon again. So definitely, it's going to grow.
Ma'am, well said. What are the possible changes that you foresee?
Changes as in?
As in like any kind of pros, like which will help
students? What we need to say is that, ma'am, there may be, having said these all possibilities or promises, as a sector or as an organization or as a professional in this field, you may be foreseeing certain challenges or obstacles in coming future.
I mean, of course, there are still a lot of challenges right now. A lot of edtechs are trying to solve for it. A lot of them, they have already solved for it. So I guess this is very similar to Mr. Priyank's field as well. So the first and the foremost thing is remote access always increases the security risk, right? It adds vulnerability in terms of ransomware, account takeovers, data security issues. This is the most important challenge that pretty much everyone faces. And there are cases where one of the attacks' data was on the black market, and it was a pretty hefty data set to be leaked, right? So those data security risks are something which is one of the challenges. Second thing is privacy concerns. I mean, when you're dealing with kids of impressionistic mindset, and specifically K3 to K10 kind of a segment, they can fall prey to child pornography. It's of utmost importance for institutes, edtech startups to protect child rights under all their products. And which is why, I mean, there are certain legal regimes which need to be in place if we are operating with kids. That said, it is a two-way street. I mean, when we are protecting the rights of children, we need to protect rights of the person on the other side, maybe the organization. So a lot of privacy concerns are there because the webcam is on, the person on the other side can see whatever is happening in the background, and similarly, like, it's a two-way street, right? So yeah, these are the two challenges I can really think of.
Okay, so how long does it take an average educator to learn how to use and implement the products of edtech companies?
There's no defined answer to this. Depends on access to hardware, type of coaching, individual grit to learn. I mean, there's no defined answer to this. It's a very individualistic question. I mean, depends on the individual who's learning. So
I take this opportunity when I am so curious about this sector. I just take the opportunity to intervene. I mean, if we see that the most of the teachers in India are basically very much fond of chalk and talk teaching kind of thing.
Yeah.
I mean, the kind of thing you have said is very correct, that this gamification, these simulations, these things are coming up in a big way. Flipped class, all these things are coming up in a big way. But most of our respected and renowned teachers in the country, they are very much aware and familiar with the chalk and talk, and they are perhaps they deliver better if a chalk and talk is there. So
no, that's a myth.
Do you feel that these next generation teachers are very much replacing the classroom, any psychological barrier between these teachers and students while taking the class online?
See, Mr. Biswas, it starts with the mindset, okay? Nobody is trying to replace the conventional teaching methodology or the pedagogy that teachers used to use or still are using, right? This is basically adding to what they already know. The upside of this is, let's say someone is in a tier two, tier three city, right? Someone is like supremely educated, but unfortunately, because of certain family circumstances, they are stuck in a tier two, tier three city, and they don't have really avenues to market themselves or earn the kind of money they can actually earn, right? Mm. Now, if an edtech is hiring and they only want teachers to teach remote, then you can operate from that tier two, tier three city. And if you already have the skill, you have now got a platform where you can make money, right? So that's one. The other thing is how quickly people have adopted things in last 1 year. Mm. Right? I mean, even when I have studied through and through like online and I was well acquainted with technology, still it was like not a easy or smooth shift on virtual platform. Initially, we all had apprehensions, right? How it's going to work. It's not collaborative. People won't show up. There are 1,000 things, 1,000 risks, right? But pretty much everyone has adopted to this technology. And even the teachers who primarily are like chalk and talk kind of teachers, or people who actually just use writing as an expression to teach, right? They also figured out ways in which they figured out like various small time setups where they could teach online, but they were still using that chalk and paper. I mean, we saw a lot of those videos going viral when COVID was on its peak, and teachers were using these small tricks to actually explain their students better, right? And I categorically remember this mirror image thing. So camera flips mm-hmm. everything. So everything was like upside down for a lot of teachers. They figured out a way that how it would like reflect correctly on camera. So it's about skill, and I guess this is going to aid them, help them only. It's not actually replacing any of the jobs. It's giving them a platform.
Yeah, I agree with you, ma'am. And so far you have talked about this strength of this edtech sector and this technology in education sector. You yeah. talked about these opportunities and also the challenges. But as a professional from this particular field, do you find any weakness of edtech sector, specific weakness?
Technology comes at a cost. So okay. even when I myself am an engineer, I still feel technology comes at a cost. And there are a lot of risks which are involved. Like I said, privacy and security mm-hmm. concerns are the major ones. That said, a lot of other risks are something to do with health. And maybe I am biased towards this because I have always had a life where, you know, I was involved in extracurricular activities. So I feel that when you are just doing things virtually, you are not really exposed to that peer learning or learning through various kinds of activities. Of course, a lot of things can be replicated online, but still, I mean, the in-person learning has its own advantages. So that's one thing which I feel students, they'd lack on if everything, you know, switches to virtual. I'd explain this with an example. Let's say someone is doing an MBA in a campus, and then someone is doing an MBA online. There's a lot of difference because you don't get to do those group activities, right? So you don't get to, you know, collaborate and maybe do certain marketing or branding campaigns. You don't get to do that, right? So that's there. And similarly, like in an office setup, there are a lot of engagement things that you can do when you're on floor. The communication is much better, easier. And similarly, like if it's something to do with finance, people, they right away won't give you their details if you are asking it online. In-person meets, they have higher conversions because there's credibility involved. So those risks are there with technology. And I don't see them evading anytime soon.
So thank you for this answer. But as we are conducting this webinar on live on Facebook, mm-hmm. so there would be many possibility that there would be many policymakers or decision makers would visit this live streaming or even yeah. recorded version of that. So using this platform, would you like to give any kind of message to the policymakers that this kind of changes in the ecosystem perhaps would be making this edtech sector more reaching to the larger audience or more be fruitful in coming future?
Sure. So I feel it's a boon for teachers because, people can be great teachers. It's not essentially required that they are great marketeers, right? So it's more of an avenue for those people who really want to explore something, go larger in terms of what they can do and make a larger impact. Then in terms of, if there are any policy makers or decision makers from other edtechs who are listening to this, then it's a message for them that it's always good to grow on technology and to build things which are disrupting, right? But the underlying message should always be connected to the roots, connected to being human and making sure that maybe at every completion of every single chapter, we are reiterating and telling the students the need to calm down, to not be part of that rat race and be themselves, be authentic and spend some time on non-virtual platforms as well, because it's equally important. from health perspective. So that's something which, I mean, if every time you're reiterating, then the change will happen. So yeah, these are the two things which I would definitely want.
Thank you, Ms. Khanna, and we will get back to you again at the end of the. Now it's the. Now we would like to hear from Mr. Priyank Agarwal, and my student Anamitra is eagerly waiting to ask questions to Mr. Priyank Agarwal regarding the fintech sector. So Anamitra, would you please start your proceedings?
Yes, sir. Good evening to our honorable guest speakers and professors and everyone else present here. First, I would thank all the professors for giving me the opportunity to interact with our respected guest speakers. As we are pursuing PGDM, so we would like to know few things about the fintech industry with some queries. So my first query will be sir, can you explain or shed light about the operation model and the revenue generator, how they generate revenue?
Sure. So I think this is a big mystery for a lot of people, that how can fintech companies keep giving cashbacks and not take anything from them, and yet be valued at so many billions of dollars. I think it's not that big a mystery. If you look closely, you will be able to figure it out. The biggest thing with fintech is, yeah, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So the biggest thing with fintech is, it is the only industry in the whole world which is actually sector agnostic. Okay. So if I were to be a Unilever, I would operate in grocery, right? If I am a Lee or a Pantaloons, I'm operating in apparel. Or if I am an Apollo, I'm operating in pharma and hospitals and healthcare. But fintech, because it deals with money and transactions, is everywhere, right? There is no business which does not involve a transaction, which is, you know, a give and take or exchange of money. So as long as there is exchange of money in anything, fintech will be there. So because the scope and the canvas is so wide, it's all about scale. So when you talk about PhonePe as an application, we process around $337 billion of money every year. To help you understand what is the meaning of $337 billion of money, the entire annual turnover of the biggest corporate group in the country, which is Reliance Group. So when you combine all their companies put together, oil and gas, apparel, jewels, electronics, everything, their entire annualized turnover is about $100 billion for the entire year. And PhonePe, being a 4-year-old company, processes 4 times that amount of money in a single year. And this will only grow to double or triple in every year, right? So that's the amount of money that we are handling. We have around 28 crore customers who have downloaded the PhonePe app. 28 crore, how to understand it? There are 130 crores is the population of the country, right? Around 70 crore people have a smartphone. So 28 crore means every second person having a smartphone has the app. Now, that's not the staggering number. The staggering number is, out of these 28 crore people, 12 crore are active every month. And those 12 crore who are active every month, they open the application and do a transaction around 16 times in a month. Every consumer on an average, and there are consumers who do as many as 30 to 40 transactions and even 100 transactions in a month. The average being 16 to 17. Why? Because you'll send money 2 to 3 times to your friend or family or relative. That's one. Then you will be having use cases like you'll be paying all the bills that I was just talking about, right? You'll do some mobile recharge, some DTH recharge, some broadband payment, some kind of gas, electricity, water bill. Then you will do all those offline cases where you'll get your fuel, you'll get your medicines, grocery, etc., etc. And then comes all your investments and everything else. So the the interfacing that you have with the application is very huge. Now, where I am coming to is coming to your question about revenue. The fact that I have so many users and there are so many impressions on the application, every section of my app is much more valued than any section of a Flipkart or a Zomato or an Ola or everything. So the ad revenue, the banners that you see on the fourth tab, that's one big chunk of revenue for us. That's one, which is easily understandable, for which I don't need to charge my consumer. I just need to charge the person who is giving that ad on my application. So our ad revenue is big. Second, all these bill payments that happen through our app, we earn very small amounts of commission on that. So small that they are much lesser than any retail commission which happen in the offline world. So the billers also don't mind getting their bills paid through our app. But the volume and the amount of those transactions is so high that we make a sizable chunk of money through them also. So that's the second source of revenue, commissions on the bill payments and recharges. Third source of revenue is some of the large merchants where you pay either an online merchant or an offline large merchant. We charge some kind of commission, which is called as an MDR or a merchant discount rate. That becomes a third source of income through us, right? The fourth source of income becomes our financial products, which are now scaling up like just like that. We sold coronavirus in, we were the first company to bring insurance for COVID-19. And we sold more number of coronavirus insurance policies than the largest insurer of the country, right? At just 200 rupees, you are giving coronavirus insurance. So we make some small margin on all the mutual funds, gold, and you know, deposits, etc., that are done through the application. So like that, I hope that helps you understand the revenue model for us. So you are not spending anything directly. You are getting everything comfortably. You are getting everything cheap. The merchant is getting contactless payments. And yet we are also making some decent money there. So very rare, but it's truly a win-all kind of scenario, right? And the reason is scale.
Thank you so much. Now I will put forward my next query. That will be, Indian being a conservative in nature, what is your view on the promise on fintech and how a fintech company adds more value to and attracts new generations?
I agree. As compared to the world, India is conservative. But I would like to amend that slightly. I think India has been conservative, right? The new India, which is coming up, is not exactly conservative, right? We, if you look at, you know, the graph or how the pyramid is there, you know, India has this demographic dividend which yields the largest amount of share to people in the age group of anywhere between 14 to 34 years of age, right? If you look at this age bracket, this is the age bracket which has learned to grow up with technology, which has been wowed with technology. They started with the first set of television, to now tablets and laptops and, you know, OTT content available now. And, you know, there's nobody, I think, if there is anybody on this call of 51 people, including all the respected professors, who says that I've not watched anything on Netflix or Amazon Prime or Zee or Hotstar, then that will be criminal, I believe, right? Let alone cable TV and all those kind of things. So India has been conservative. It's not that much conservative now. There is a section which is sort of conservative, which shies away from linking their bank account on a payment application, thinking that somebody may take away your money. Nobody takes away your money. You literally give your money, right? You give your money because of either two reasons. A, you fall prey to greed. Somebody tells you you've won a lottery and you just go gaga about it and, you know, you end up losing your money. Or you fall prey to your own innocence and somebody takes advantage of that, right? It's either your greed or your innocence because of which you lose money, not because somebody takes it away from you. Coming back to the fact that it's not really, really that we are conservative. We have been conservative. I think there's a huge rate of huge change in the mindset. It's also convenience, right? If anything we have inertia. Human beings have inertia to move from one state to another. But at the same time, we are 70% made of water, right? So we'll slide down the path of least resistance also, right? So because we slide down the path of least resistance, if there is a payment method which is seamless, convenient, where you don't have to worry about change, where you don't have to worry about, you know, carrying a hefty wallet, where you don't have to worry about waiting or touching or anything, then you start adopting that. I think the future in all perspectives looks bright. It's a very neat and clean sector to be in. Not one of those sectors where I have to do any kind of push sales to any. Best part, I being a business development and sales professional, I feel that from an employer and employee point of view, this is a sector where you tell the value prop to a person and he or she decide whether they want to adopt it or not. And that percentage of people increasingly wanting to adopt is very high. So yeah, I guess, did I answer your question?
Net banking, yes. Also serve the same part, serve the same service, that paying that cashless transaction.
Anamitra, can you repeat?
Anamitra, let me reframe the question. Okay. Mr. Agarwal, you said quite correctly that we are experiencing a new wave in India in all aspects. But you see that Indian financial system is mostly regulated. It's controlled by different regulatory authorities. So in this context, and the question that Anamitra is eager to ask, perhaps as I understand, is that people can stay within this regulated system and take the help of net banking these days. So how do you see that while operating under this regulated environment, this fintech sector would have so much of promise to generate? How they are differentiating their promise?
Yes, sir.
So see, the regulators so far, have played a very critical role in enabling the growth. And they have so far been enabling all the various stakeholders, and the regulator themselves in this sector is adapting itself to the new changes. There are a lot of gray areas when it comes to regulatory norms in this sector. For example, KYC of merchants, KYC of consumers, the norms are still being written down, the rules are being written, and the regulator is also learning as the sector is growing, because probably the growth of the sector has surpassed even the regulator's expectation, right? But having said that, see, the key person to gain from the growth of this sector is the regulator himself. This is not a case where the regulator is intervening because it has to act as a regulator itself. Here, the regulator is the biggest benefactor, right? Because with the advent and penetration of digital payments, it is the regulator who will get the most amount of tax revenue collection as a result of all your bank getting converted to point. That's the key objective. And that is the reason why the regulator is very aggressively pushing for the growth of this sector and keeping UPI at such a low cost or at zero cost rather. And the growth of UPI is far, far ahead of GDP growth, economy growth, credit card growth, digital payment growth. It's single-handedly, sweeping everything on one side. And now there are talks of, introducing parallel platforms, UPI 2.0 and other, NFC kind of thing. So yes, I see regulator as a friend here. I see regulator of an enabler, because the regulator is also a beneficiary of the growth of the.
Thank you so much for detailed explanation.
Now, please move on to your next question.
Yes. So my next question will be, what will be the possible challenges? Like, will the fintech company replace the bank, or any cyber crimes related to phishing?
No, definitely we will not replace the bank. The banks provide you a very different kind of service. Portfolio of the banks is huge. They have deposits, they have money growth options, they have lockers, they have loans as instruments, They have customized surveys, they have portfolio management. So all those things, no fintech can replace. We are just enabling one piece here, the exchange of money, right? The facilitating the exchange of money. All the other instruments that we have, which are money growth options and money management options, their backbone is NBFCs and banks only. We do not have our own, so far at least, a phone pay mutual. We are sitting Aditya or Kotak or Axis, any of these partner banks funds only. There is no way in which we are replacing banks in near future at least. When it comes to threats to the industry, there is no industry in our country which is not prone to fraud or which is not prone to deceit. Why? Because we have this very big group in the country which is educated, unemployed youth, right? Now, the combination of these three words is the most dangerous combination, right? Because you are educated, you have the acumen, you have the know-how of things. Because you are unemployed, you don't have the right direction to do these things, right? And because you are youth, you are invincible and you are on the top of the food chain. So because of this food segment that is there in the country of educated, unemployed youth, it is these folks who end up using their creativity into the wrong direction and trying on innocent markets and innocent consumers. Education among consumers is the only way to solve the problem. As simple as not sharing OTPs on phone, as simple as not falling prey to 10,000 Singapore dollars lottery wins and, you know, cashbacks and all. It is as simple as that's all. I think it's percolating, but yes, because it's such a vast country, there are still incidents on and off that you hear of.
Yeah, taking clue from your answer, Mr. Agarwal, I mean, you are talking about this growth prospect of this fintech sector. So the kind of explanation you give right now, I'm just curious to ask that, do you see that any kind of threats or challenges that you are thinking that this a fintech sector would experience or should work upon?
See, one thing is penetration. See, a lot of the challenges which are there, they're already getting addressed. So one is penetration of smartphones and internet. Right? With the advent of cheaper cost smartphones and internet becoming drop dead cheap. Like India has the lowest cost of internet among the world. And right now some of the cheapest good quality handsets are available in the country. So the reach is increasing. The second is having bank accounts, because you need to have a bank account to link perfectly to UPI. I think with Jan Dhan accounts and a lot of, you know, private bank aggressively opening accounts digitally, zero balance and all that kind of things, these challenges are also getting sorted. Last is the final nail in the coffin is the trust of the consumer, to be able to trust their money with us and be able to ensure that those payments, if we migrated from one account. I think that UPI has created a lot of trust. And the good part here is you don't have to have upfront trust here. You can start small. You can start by sending 1 rupee and see whether it arrives rightly in the right frame of time without any debt. Then you migrate to 10 rupees, then 100, 1,000 and lakhs. So I think there is not much of a challenge. It's more about education, trust. Yeah. I think, and as a country, we are very much on the right. We ourselves have now started penetrating to towns and villages with as low as 5,000 population. And we are acquiring merchants there and consumers there. 75% of our transactions now come from beyond tier 2 cities. That means, you know, that Bharat part of the country also is adopting to digital payments and becoming savvy there.
Okay.
So what are the action plans the fintech companies are taking regarding these challenges?
But I just reframe your question, perhaps Mr. Agarwal, yeah. That he wants to say that, you know, having said these are the challenges, And also, you couple of times you have mentioned that this inclusion of the people to the system is also a challenge. So having said these challenges, what are the action plans or what are the ways that these fintech companies are adopting to overcome these challenges?
So I think one is increasing the reach, you know, by going deeper into, you know, the smaller geographies and creating our presence there. That I think is one way. Definitely we are doing that, and we are investing big time into that. The second is by increasing the number of use cases for a consumer, right? So it started with payment transfers, bill payments and all. Now we are increasing the use cases to more and more you know options where you can use your wealth and grow your wealth on the platform. That's probably the second way in which we are tackling this. The third is obviously educating. So, you know, talking about the features that we have, you know, advertising and, you know, increasing the trust of the consumer into our platform. So yeah, I guess these are some of the ways we are trying to increase the reach and increase the. There's a lot of organic growth itself that we are seeing, right? So while we continue to focus on levers of growth, we need to ensure that we are in a position where our systems, processes, and tools are in a position to be able to handle the volumes, because this is all your hard-earned money, right? We need to be very, very responsible while we send your money from one place to another. The system has to be foolproof. And learning from our success story, countries of Europe and America are now wanting to adapt, you know, like a UPI kind of digital payments application. Countries which have traditionally been so heavy on plastic, hard money, they are wanting to adopt. There are case studies where they are studying India as a country and NPCI as the platform which has launched UPI. So I think we're doing a lot to increase consumer adoption.
So I'm sure that. Thank you so much, Mr. Agarwal, for explaining in such a lucid way. I mean, it's such a lucid way to explain. You have explained the whole complex thing, and thank you very much. I'm sure that my students all are very much curious about their prospect and their future in both these two sectors. I mean, this is an obvious thing. If I could have been a student, I would have asked these questions to you. But I'm sure that they are having something in their mind. So may I request Anamitra to ask one more last question to both the speakers before we go for question and answer session.
So being an aspiring candidate and potential employee, we want your valuable views on employability factors, like how a student like us may prepare himself or herself to become a successful professional in edtech and fintech, both the sectors. What type of career opportunity we may expect?
Is it a question for both the speakers?
Yes.
Nah. So first I request Ms. Khanna to answer this, because Mr. Agarwal is speaking for last minute.
So yeah. I think the answer will be similar, but let's hear Neha first.
So,
I mean, I guess I've answered this question in so many campus drives as well. So it's really important that when you are applying for any kind of job, right, you research the role well, you prepare questions for the interviewer, you research about the organization, and then take the plunge, right? It's really important to prepare yourself before you jump onto any kind of professional stint. That said, just be yourself in most of those interviews. And when it comes to picking sectors, I guess both EdTech and FinTech, they are doing fantabulous right now. You can pick any of them. They are rocket ships any which ways, right? And in terms of employability, it's always good to have some edge to your profile. And I believe curriculum is one thing which obviously gives you theoretical knowledge, but to implement it practically, you need certain exposure. So if feasible, please do invest in an internship where you get a real-time exposure. You get to actually play with some sort of a data. You get some hands-on experience, and that is going to groom you. That's going to help you. And
you know, refine you. I am reachable on LinkedIn just in case, you know, you have lengthier questions or maybe questions which are interlinked and I can't answer them right now. We can chat there.
Okay. Yeah? Thank you, ma'am, for answering this question. And one of our student 2 years back who passed out, she's now working in UpGrad right now. She was also talking like that. It's a completely new experience that I am experiencing. So as you said correctly, and taking clue from your words, let's move to Mr. Agarwal to get his valuable views.
So see, half of my last 10 years have been spent in taking interviews, right? So one of the key things which I, let me just try and explain how I hire or why I would hire you or why I would not hire you. Let me just explain that. See, you have most of the roles that you will land up in fintech or edtech, unless you are, because you chose to do an MBA, right? So once you've chosen to do an MBA, you have let go of the technology route. So you can't be an engineer or a product guy anymore, right? So that road you have left. Now what you have left ahead is the road to business or human resources as a function or probably operations. Now let Neha answer maybe HR related questions and operations. Let's leave it aside because of these two industries are not at all operation intensive, but these are technology industries. So let me answer my forte, which is sales and business development. And I'm sure most of the hiring that will happen in these two sectors for you folks will be on the business development and sales kind of profiles. Now, first of all, you have to be open to the idea of being a sales guy. That's the first fundamental blocker. I see a lot of guys coming in and say, can I do marketing? Can I do branding? Can I do this? There's nothing like marketing or branding. First of all, this is all a myth. Nobody does branding or marketing in a company. The only person who does marketing or branding in a company is the CEO, who works with an agency and tells them this is how my brand should look. So if you think you are going to be a brand guy, there's nothing like a brand guy in a company. It's only the CEO and his vision of how he sees the brand. That's one. So be open to the idea of sales. See, in a career span of 30 years of corporate, suppose you are at 25 years of age and you plan to work for 30 to 35 years in corporate, that's unless you have a big pool of money or a big business waiting back for you at home, that's how long you'll have to work to continue to feed yourself, then your wife and then children and then your family thereon. So in a span of 30 to 35 years of corporate career, first 3 to 4 years, you need to invest in something where you will learn the ground reality of things. And then you can be in a position and, you know, to give yarn to a lot of your fellow people that, you know, when I was in the front line, I used to do this, I used to do that. And I have had that kind of tough scenarios in life. So invest the first few years on the ground, learning things the hard way. Don't hesitate to move to merchants, move into consumer homes, talk to them and tell them about the product. You will face tough situations, but that's how you'll get ready for the world. So first thing is be open to the idea of sales and get ready for it. Second, speak well, talk well. You have to present well. You know, you might be a great ranker. You might be scoring good marks in your 10th, 12th graduation, post-graduation. But if you're not able to pitch, if you're not able to talk clearly, you know, you will not be able to grab attention of anyone, right? If you're not able to grab attention, you will not be able to hold the attention. And if you're not able to hold the attention, you will not be able to close that sale. So work on your communication skills. If you know you are great at it, fine. If you know you have that that as a weak spot, work on it. And being in a B school, you have made the first decision, right? That B school is the platform where with so many live projects, case studies, presentations, group work, blah, blah, so on, so many things, you at least learn to work on your communications. That's the second. Third thing, I think don't worry too much about what next. Right? There are so many times that you get into your first job and then you're immediately worrying what next. I have been doing sales for 6 months. It's been so long. Now what do I do next? 6 months is nothing. Okay. 1 year is nothing. 2 years is nothing. So just be open. Just go with the flow. If you are a talent, you know, the organization is more worried about utilizing you than yourself. don't get hassled by, you know, what next for me. So these are things that I've seen with youngsters, because I have 520 members in my team, out of which 400 are college freshers and people with 1 year experiences, good boys and, you know, gentlemen and ladies. And today I'm in Hyderabad speaking to one such group, and their immediate question is, what next? I mean, you have 6 months, don't worry about what next so early. It will come to you.
You are saying, Priyank, my team gets a question pretty often. Ma'am, what are the office timings? Guys, you are just starting your career. I mean, for one goddamn reason, because you are starting your career, don't really think about the work-life balance in the very beginning. It can come later, of course, if you work hard. Right? But these are...
I say to that, you know, it's not so much about... If you work smartly...
Yeah.
You can achieve all kinds of work-life balance. I have people who are learning dance, music, managing triple relations, everything along with their work also, right? So, and they're doing fantastically well in their work also. So you just have to work smart.
It's been a quite engrossing session for me as well. Because I feel rejuvenated with your ideas and with your talking and all these things. And I would love to be your student or associated somewhere in some capacity, in some collaboration. I would love to be associated with you. Because being a teacher, I always feel that it's not like that once, it is not a one-sided story. Whatever we teach in the class, it's not that it's the sacrosanct thing that we are going to teach the students. It is also important, equally important, to take the views where they implement those ideas. So that's the purpose, that's why we are organizing so many webinars, and we always welcome and request the eminent professionals like you to come and teach even the some sections or some part of the courses which we offer, because we want that the student should be developed holistically, not just from a one-dimensional perspective in a myopic way. So let me just quickly sum up the session before we move to the question answer session. So it was a really a fabulous session for which I am being a moderator, and I feel very difficult to moderate these sessions because they have said so many things and in such a lucid manner. So I would keep it short. It was started with generic questions like what are kind of implications that these digital disruptions have had on our life, day-to-day life, industrial life. And both the speakers have presented in a way that technology is the life today. When life, you cannot imagine life without technology. So be it a professional or personal, it's a technology which is blending life with the actions and all these things. And particularly, I would mention that Mr. Agarwal said that very lucidly, very well said, that there's a journey of money journey. I mean, this is a term, particular term, which I heard for the first time. I mean, this coinage I heard for the first time, and thank you so much for mentioning that, the sending, spending, then managing, and then growing. And in the same context, Ms. Khanna also talked about this immersive learning, gamifications, all these things are being a part of our life, our education system. Next, the questions that the speakers answered in the sector-specific questions, like, for example, that... how these disruptions are making these sectors so promising. And in that context of EdTech sector, Ms. Khanna explained the operation part, and she also explained the benefits like reach to the wider audience, having the less infrastructure, less spending, but giving you more value to the remote access. And also she explained certain kind of concern about this technological use, because every good thing has an opposite side also. She said that about this ransomware data security, then bandwidth issues may be a challenge, possible challenge. Privacy and security issues are coming up in a big way. And But nevertheless, this edtech sector is providing an enormous opportunity in personification of education. I mean, you can personify or you can customize the education based on the user's needs, based on the skill set. I can well remember the education system of Finland, wherein a child is grouped, a group of children is taught at a classroom, and from the very early age, they identify their hidden talents and accordingly design their career path. So I can understand that this thing, edtech sector will revolutionize all this educational journey, even in the higher education sector. And being a professor of decision science and operations management, and I don't think that I am belonging to that group of that aged group, but still, it's a new journey for us also. I mean, we teachers are very much familiar with the psychological connect with the students in that builds between the classroom in a face-to-face teaching. But we are experiencing a change and we are adapting to these changes to build our connect with the students, even if we are digitally divided, digitally distant, physically distant, but digitally connected. Now, coming to this fintech sector, I mean, the operational part, the revenue model, it was explained so lucidly by Mr. Agarwal. I mean, perhaps one aspiring candidate who is just having an interview tomorrow should listen to his lecture today of this operational part, because the interview preparation is over by this operational part. So he explained that how this PhonePe or the fintech companies generate their revenues in terms of advertisement, in terms of sharing the platform, all these things he explained. And then he also explained that he talked about this inclusion, financial inclusions, all these kind of challenges for making this fintech sector to reach a larger users in our country. But the most promising part is that he is very much hopeful that this new India is experiencing a tremendous transformation. And as a result of that, he doesn't find any kind of threat for the banks already. And according to him is that this regulator itself is promoting this sector because they are very much associated with this sector. So, and he said that this PhonePe or any fintech company is not going to replace any bank. Rather, they are going to augment the bank, make the tax easy for the banks, and they want to collaborate or they want to create an holistic system, taking banks and all regulators as their partner or as a integral part of this ecosystem to make the overall transactions and financial market a very promising one. So with these sessions being conducted, now it's the time to allow the listeners to ask questions. So we have already few questions. One question is for both the speakers. They say that the question is, India being a developing country is not high in technology literacy and accessibility. How would those who are unable to utilize and access their technological benefit can take advantage of these sectors like edtech and fintech? And what are the steps to be taken to enable this? I mean, I understand the question is basically India is not that high in technology literacy and accessibility. So as a professional or as a leader of both this sector, how would you see that this kind of challenge can be overcome?
I would not deny we have faced this kind of challenge even while recruiting, because a lot of households, they really don't have this concept of seamless internet connectivity and having access to drives. And business-wise also, I guess Priyank works for a company where, you know, it's an app-based business and pretty much large audience have access to smartphones. However, EdTech is primarily driven on desktops or gadgets like tablet, and not every household has that. So a lot of fintech partners, they actually are willing to provide such gadgets on EMIs, those who actually wish to invest on it. And that said, there are other
channels like, where we have configured, we have tried giving scholarships to a lot of students and gave them gadgets on a subsidized rates. So all those few hacks we could pull off, but yeah, I mean, it is a challenge. India is not ever ready market where, you know, all of these gadgets are available, or I mean, seamless internet connectivity is available, and still internet is definitely an issue. Even if you pay for a fiber optic cable, you'd still face those internet issues, right? So that's something that I don't think it's specific to any kind of an organization. We can't solve for it at the moment. Yeah.
So Mr. Agarwal, would you like to add to it this question, because the question is for both of you?
Yeah, but only thing I will say is, yes, there is challenge. That's just because we are a huge country, and you know, whatever resources you put into this nation, they dry up like a drop of water on a dry land, right? It's like that. But the point is, there is a lot of improvement which is coming in primarily because of the cost of using these things have come down. The cost of smartphones, cost of devices, and the cost of internet. With that coming down drastically, I think see the rate at which all the technology industries are growing in the country, I think that itself tells whether there is a challenge or whether, you know, it's an opportunity. I think what we are seeing as an untapped market is more of an opportunity. It's like, you know, you're seeing a glass half full or a half empty. I am seeing it as half full and the other half yet to be filled. You know, because the rate at which technology is reaching deeper, that is giving time for the organizations to set up their processes in a timely way. Had all 130 crore people of the country been already ready with technology, smartphones, and probably we would not have been able to cater them also at one go. Probably because it is expanding one by one, we are able to reach to them also, we are able to develop platforms also, and we are able to grow also. So I don't think it's a challenge. I don't think it's a barrier. I think it's an opportunity which is getting tapped with all hands on deck now, with the regulator being in place, with telecom in place, with smartphone industry being in place, with good guys developing technology also. So there's another limitation which is on the part of real talent for tech guys to come in and develop those products which can be consumed by consumers. Making these cool apps and platforms is not an easy task, right? We are now competing with the likes of Google, who is, say, coming in with Google Pay or WhatsApp with WhatsApp Pay, or Amazon with Amazon Pay. These are like global giants, and we are leading the market against them because of the products that our engineers in-house in Bangalore, Pune cities have been able to build. So I think it's no more a challenge. I think it's all an opportunity.
So another interesting question in this context for both the speakers raised by the participant is that how would the new security technologies like use of blockchain and high-end computing like quantum computing that are influencing or affecting both the sectors?
See, blockchain is a very specific technology. With the basis of blockchain, I don't need to explain everyone. Everyone knows, probably, those who have little interest in technology also. But it's about sharing very secure information across multiple stakeholders. The most common use of blockchain, which everybody is aware, is Bitcoin, right? Bitcoin is the place where blockchain started. Hmm. In case of banking and financial services, blockchain is relevant to KYCs as a major use. Hmm. How if a bank does KYC, that same KYC database can be used by all the vendors who are using that banking platform. It's a technology that is coming up. It is being put to use. I'm not so sure how much we use it right now, but then in banking and financial services, KYC is one use case where blockchain definitely is put to use.
So Ms. Khanna, would you like to add your views on this question? Because the question is for both the speakers.
So Biswas, I lost you. Can you repeat the last line again?
So this question was for both the speakers. So would you like to add your views on this blockchain and quantum computing?
I don't think blockchain is that relevant in edtech.
It's not really, there's
not sharing of same information across multiple stakeholders.
Yeah.
It's one central repository of information which is shared downline to multiple students, right? So not much of a relevance I see from my understanding.
There is no practical use case as well. I mean, where any of the edtechs across the globe, they have embedded something like that. So it's more related, like Priyank said, it's more related to use of cryptocurrency like Bitcoin. That's where the use case is. And fintech is the only industry where it's largely used at the moment. So,
okay. Yeah. So we can take one more question before we formally wrap up the session. I mean, I didn't understand that is going for last 1.5 hours. It was so interesting sessions. So it runs after 1.5 hours, it is going on, but I hardly realized that. So I can only take one more question. So anyone, please raise the question. Anyone, please type the question in the chat box quickly before we formally close the session.
There's one question there from...
Yes, sir. There is a question there in the chat box from Akansha Raj.
And that question already is answered. I see the question. There is a Google Pay and Paytm. But Mr. Agarwal quite wisely answered this question because he probably has anticipated that this question might come. So before the question come, he answered that. So I can allow one more question. Please, anyone who is having a question. Okay. So how would this new technology that is augmented and virtual reality affect the edtech sector? The question is for Ms. Khanna.
This is actually something which most edtechs are exploring. Of course, that's the new big thing in edtech. With the restricted approach in terms of what we can do in reality, to giving that whole new horizon and demographics to these kids, I guess virtual reality is the new big thing and the next big thing in edtech space. Of course, there are a lot of things which are going on. I mean, one of the biggest giants like Baiju's, they tapped into this market and clubbed with Disney for younger kids. Not a very successful pilot at the moment, but I mean, yeah, that's the next big thing, and a lot of edtechs are exploring that. And it makes sense also because gamification is already part of edtech space. We are trying to create impressionistic, immersive learning lessons which have scaffolding approach where it's catching the beat or the pulse of the child and adapting accordingly. And if you put something like that in the whole learning experience, it's going to change the whole dynamics, how kids perceive information, how they process information. So yeah, that's going to happen soon. I mean, we'd know in a year or two.
Okay, so ultimately all good things has to have an end. So for the last 1.5 hour, what we are experiencing is a very engrossing session. So formally, it's now my turn to close down the session. Before I close the session formally, I would like to express our sincere thanks to both the speakers for spending their valuable time in rather educating us about the two sectors. So being a professor also, I have no hesitation in saying that it was an educational session for us also. And I thank all the senior management of Calcutta Business School and our respected mentors and core committee members for allowing us to create these opportunities for our students to give them an exposure to learn about the new emerging sectors. And in an effect, it also gives us an opportunity to learn from the industry practitioners. And I also thank my students for attending this session so patiently, and perhaps this is a learning session for them. They must have, I'm sure that they have enjoyed this session thoroughly. And these two are totally emerging sector and a huge prospect is there. And this is a coming next generation employer. These two sectors are next generation employer. So I think they must have enjoyed a lot. I would be failing in my duty if I do not express my thanks to Pragya, because she has all taken the pain to coordinate it with the speakers and make this program happen. And I thank all the my faculty colleagues, respected principal in charge, to be with us and to make this event successful. I would personally love to attend the sessions of Mr. Priyank and Ms. Khanna, not in a clubbed way, but an individual session in the campus. Hopefully, COVID will go away soon. And as it is said in the biodata of Mr. Priyank, he lives in the country. So for coming to Kolkata is not a big deal for him. So I invite right now, I on behalf of Calcutta Business School, it's my open invitation to you, Mr. Agarwal, whenever you get time and whenever such COVID session is over, situation is a bit okay. So we would love to, we would be honored and we would love to hear you at our campus. And same is true for Ms. Khanna also, because this is something, a sector on which currently one of my student is working. His dissertation project is on EdTech sector. So he is working on EdTech sector. So, and I personally would like to attend your session at our campus. So it is on behalf of Calcutta Business School. I also invite you, whenever such situation gets over, please come to your campus and address our students, meet our professors and our respected core committee members and the mentors, so that we build a relationship, long-term enduring relationship among us, because industry and institute, I strongly believe, both should have an enduring relationship. Otherwise, education is not complete. So with this, let me say thank you. And formally, I am closing down the session. So good night. Stay well. Take care.
Thank you, everyone. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Biswas. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.